what we inherit, the emotional influences from our family of origin, has a huge shaping factor in how calm we might feel in the body or how anxious and uncertain we might feel in life. The other influence is our very earliest experience. So what happened when we were in our mom's womb? What were the first experiences, the first few hours, the first few weeks and months of our lives? They really shape how we move through life. And I'll share with you one of my client stories in just a bit that illustrates that perfectly. But first, I wanted to start off with a quote that, wouldn't you know it, came into my inbox just this week. And I thought, isn't this perfect to share with the anxiety talk? So I just wrote it down here. If we hope to live in a nonviolent world, it also felt very timely with what we're hearing on the news today. And where we want a world of respect and kindness to be able to replace fear, hatred, we must begin with how we treat each other at the beginning of life, for this is where the deepest patterns are set. From these roots, we can grow fear and alienation instead of roots of love and trust. Suzanne Arms was the author of that quote, and I thought it was absolutely perfect and just right on to what we're going to talk about here today. None of us get to be the way we are by accident. And the roots of our very early experience influences, you know, how we bond in relationships, even how we might navigate separation. They influence our thoughts, our beliefs, and how we move through the world. We're not born with a clean hard drive, if we give it a computer analogy. We were plugged in, if you will, to the operating system of our parents. We also share it with our grandparents. And we're actually born with feelings that we think belong to us. We think, well, that's just how I am, or that's just how my relationships go. But the truth is, it comes from somewhere. And this is what's so exciting about some of the new science today that helps us to understand how these influences are shared literally right through the DNA. The roots of anxiety, that very, very deep place from where they come from, are often from our own early separation from our parents. So if we were separated at birth for any length of time, or in my case, you know, my mom had to go back to work. I was only 6 weeks old and started in a large daycare. So this changes the way really our brain shapes, really that fundamental place we feel in connection with another. A lot of the times, those of us who have had history of adoption, let's say, really that feeling of the rug being pulled out from under, everything that was known, everything that had been the way it had been for 9 full months, just like that has changed. And it doesn't have to be something as drastic as an example as adoption either. It could be something as every day as my own example, where moms, we have to go back to work and our children get taken care of maybe by a well-meaning grandparent who is lovely, is amazing, loves this child. And yet to that little infant, it's a different smell, it's a different tone of voice, it's a different way of relating than perhaps the parent would have. And so I'm not saying that, you know, we shouldn't go back to work. This is not a judgment call. This is simply about, if you're supporting a child that has a lot of anxious feelings, a lot of fears and worries, sometimes we get caught in looking at, how do I solve this? How do I make this better? And we're only looking at it from the place of today. You know, what's being shown? How do I maybe change that behavior, or, you know, soothe this child that's so, so upset? And we don't even think to look at, what could this be about? What could this behavior be pointing to? Meaning, pointing to the early days, that the body remembers mommy having to go back to work, when all I want to feel safe and settled and calm is her smell, is her voice, is just her in close proximity. And then for many of my clients, when I begin to ask these sort of factual questions, did mom have to go right back to work? You know, is there adoption in the history? Were mom and dad fighting a lot? And, you know, no, everything was fine. Everything was good. Stay-at-home mom. Sometimes our mom is physically there, but emotionally, maybe a bit vacant. Maybe it's a postpartum depression. Maybe you have a sibling who's 2 years old and requires lots of different kind of attention and play than a newborn does. And so there can be all of these influences. And of course, they all affect us differently. I was speaking with somebody earlier this week who specializes in ADHD. She supports adults with ADHD and how they get back into having a great life. And a lot of what she says is that, you know, the parents were there, they're supportive, they're loving. It's sort of we hit all those check boxes. And yet, mom was distracted in some way, shape, or form, not giving that attunement that is optimal. And when we don't have that, it's good news that it's never too late. The latest in neuroscience lets us know that our brain, it doesn't even care about the source. So a lot of what we can do is really sit in that quiet place and even imagine, you know, the wise part of you, that the self that is grown up, that has known exactly what you need, you know, giving that infant or that child exactly what is desired, which could just simply be, you know, the image of you rocking the infant you, the image of you sitting down and playing with a puzzle or reading a book to that younger version of you. A lot of what I'll guide my clients through is imagining sitting with that part of you that, you know, looks up to mom, but, you know, she's busy with the dishes or putting a healthy dinner on the table or whatever the million things there are to do when we have a full household. And so while all that is going on, it's just you with the wisdom to sit with the younger version of you and breathe love, have that eye-to-eye connection, that open heart, I'm here with you. You know, you're way too young to have to deal with all of these feelings of being alone or overhearing the chaos that's going on in the background with mom and dad. And so if something begins to change inside the nervous system that feels like, I'm not alone in this. There's space and time for something else to emerge. And I have a few client stories that I've sort of written down here to keep note of so that I'm sure to share them with you. Here's a really profound one. And as I'm sharing it, I'd like you to bring to mind, what is your first memory of your mom? And memory's a funny thing. You know, for some of us, it doesn't even really start to become clear until we're about school age, maybe. But think back. What does the body remember about your first memory of your mom? So one of my clients, he very successful businessman, and came to me about this all too familiar anxious pulse in his body that had been there for as long as he could remember. And this really surprised me because I know him as confident. He's on many, many stages, speaking to many people. And I would always think to myself, wow, if someone has a lot of anxiety, you know, is that a place that that person would be comfortable? And as a matter of fact, he said, it's one of the environments where he feels most comfortable. And what sort of had the red flag go up for me is where the anxiety feels most tight, constricted, and intense in his body is in close, intimate relationships. So I started to ask some of those early family history questions, some of those facts around what happened. Well, he was an infant, just a few days old, and his family had to flee Vietnam. They were heading over to North America on a boat. And very sadly, he became severely dehydrated. And we all know how serious that can be from an infant, and almost died. So you could imagine the chaos, the intensity around such a situation. And then, thankfully, everything was fine. They get to where they're going. But it's a new family in a new country, a new culture, a new language, all of the things that would be required to sort of get back on solid ground. And so as a little child, as he looks up to mom for that friendly smile that all kids look to their parents for, you know, that friendly smile that lets me know I'm okay in the world. We're okay. Everything's going to be good. And likely what he saw reflected was, you know, just mom being really busy or maybe distressed, maybe even a look of worry across her face. And we internalize all of this as children. And so this gets laid down like an imprint or a map that carries with us over and over again through years and years until we can find that root. If you think of it like a garden weed and you pull it out all the way to the root, then something else can be integrated. So as we began to work on what the body remembers, in a way, what the body records, you know, so this can happen and I could lose everything. If we begin to lift up that pulse in the body, the anxiousness has a place to diffuse and we're no longer carrying it in the same way. And so I think when we look at how do we best support the children that we love, a lot of it is beginning to ask different questions. You know, so what could this nervousness about going over to a new friend's house really be about? You know, beyond, we all get a little nervous when we go into a new environment. You know, there's that kind of typical level. And then there's, we all know the children that just want to hang back and wouldn't dare to do it. So there's that part of respecting where they feel comfortable. And then also looking for, is there something else around this that I could support them with? And then from that client example, the other part that we need to consider is his parents' experience. You know, what was going on? Why were they fleeing Vietnam? What was happening even for his grandparents? Because all of those get laid down in the body and that imprint is firing all the time, giving us information. And so when we can bring in our family history, as well as our own early life experience, it's amazing how much more efficiently, quickly we can get to that resolution instead of just pushing it away and wishing it weren't here. What I find to be incredible is how much we do inherit from the family. I think a lot of us just think, oh, you know, this is my dad's hair color, or my dad's got, you know, big thick eyebrows just like me, or my mom is loving and caring, and maybe I get that from her. And the truth is, only 2% of these types of traits come from that physical personality type. And the other 98% comes from what I call relational, this experiential that lives out in us and in all of these different kinds of ways. So we get so much more than how tall we end up or the color of our eyes from our family. And this lives on in us in all kinds of ways. What I've learned in the years I spent in this discipline training, and certainly the years I've spent with clients, is that if we don't sort of know the family history, if we don't solve the background, it can come back to haunt us. It's as if what's left unresolved lives out again. And I have another story to share with you about that. There's a very famous football player. His name is Ben Roethlisberger. I'm not a football star, so I gotta check my notes here to see who he is. So he was a quarterback for the Steelers, and he was known by his teammates for being absolutely fearless on the field. You know, he would just go head in, and you know, he was really highly revered from his peers for just being this fearless player. Well, what none of his fans knew was that when he was 8 years old, his mom was running late to pick him up from school and was killed in a head-on collision, sadly. So there was a part of him that felt drawn to play football that way, you know, just head on, I'm in it, I'm doing it. And at the same age that his mom was in this head-on collision, he was in a very serious motorcycle accident and wasn't wearing a helmet. So a similar type of head injury, but thankfully was not killed. So we see again this pattern repeating as if to say, look at me, heal this, resolve this. And these are both of the stories I've shared are somewhat dramatic, are somewhat, they really, really hit the message home. And so I want to be sure at the end of our time together to just open up to any questions that you may have an example of what feels like a little bit more everyday that many of us as parents are faced with, to be sure that you get to have your question answered. I wanted to talk a little bit before opening the lines about some of the resources that are available to us if we're an adult that's kind of up against anxiety and just kind of feelings under that umbrella, or if we're supporting a child with it. So something about our brain that I found to be amazingly fascinating is that 2/3 of the time we're scanning for threats. We're alert for what's wrong or what could go wrong. And so if that's how our brain is literally set up, we have got to bring in some resources to even just pull traction away from the negative. And this comes from Rick Hansen. He's a neuroscientist that talks about the good things that happen in our life. They kind of bounce off of us like Teflon. They just boom, off they go. And yet the good the negative things, the arguments, the conflicts, they stick to us like Velcro. And so this is the same for our children. We wonder, you know, some days they come home from school, they're energized, they're happy, and other days they're completely cranky. And, you know, sure, that could be dehydration, that could be hunger. Of course, there's some physical parts to this. But the consideration that often gets missed is, what went on at the schoolyard? Were there lots of, you know, negative things thrown at you? Was there an influence of a bully there? You know, what was going on? So that we can really be supportive. We keep that open dialogue open so that they feel like we, the parent, are a soft place to land. That we can bring in this kind of bigger picture understanding to hold space for what's going on for them. Another really helpful resource for your child if they are really up against some of this heavier emotions is to find a way to bring storytelling, whether it's around the dinner table or, you know, the classic time before bed. A really important part is to be sure any of the really intense family stories don't stay a secret inside of your family. If it does, it tends to build energy, build velocity, and our children often, you know, carry the weight of that. So if we can give an age-appropriate version of what might have happened with grandma or with Aunt Betty, you know, how do we let them know some of the circumstances that were real challenges within our family? That helps to lighten what's carried inside the very, you know, this very body of our children. So storytelling is a great tool. You know, all of us, no matter how old we are, I think we all love a good story. I mean, this is why we turn to movies and lose ourselves in great books. And children, I think they crave it. You know, we're in a different time and there's not so much the sitting around the campfire telling stories concept going on anymore. So if you, the parent, can bring that in as a priority, it's a great way to connect. It's a great way to talk about, you know, really those things that matter. And you'd be amazed at how much more your child might open up about really what's burdening his or her heart or some of those fears and phobias. Because I think, yeah, I'm just thinking back to the main fears and phobias I've supported even adults through. Each and every time it's come back to something that lives in the family. You know, phobia of riding in elevators, flying in airplanes, even heights. It doesn't take too much to track it back to where there was a severe accident or loss of life, or even that sense of confinement and what that can relate to in an earlier generation. Another resource that is great that pulls traction away from the negative thoughts, and which is our default, you know, believe it or not, is beautiful and easy things like breath work. You know, when my son has a hard time falling asleep, sometimes I'll talk to him about, let's imagine we're filling our belly up like a balloon. And right away, that engages deep diaphragmic, slow breathing. But to the child, they're kind of playing with that image of filling their belly up like a balloon. You know, we keep it fun. We keep it age-related. And breath work and what it gives to the body and to the nervous system, gosh, that's been around for decades, eons. And it's just such a great resource to tune into. One of my favorites is essential oils. We've got a whole bunch in the house, and some are specifically great for bringing about deeper calm. My favorites that I turn to are chamomile, lavender. They're classic. They're probably found in any health food store in your community. And what I do is use them on the bottoms of the feet. All the nerve endings for our whole body are in the bottom of the feet. So if you put a few drops on right before bed, it really, really helps to settle things. Or even right after school, if that seems to be a charged time for your child. So those are some of the considerations, some of the resources that might help things be a little more easeful in your home environment. So I just wanted to thank everybody for coming on to the call. And for those of you who are listening afterwards, I'd mentioned in the beginning that if you have any questions about what I shared or anything you'd like to talk about specifically with what's going on in your household, do feel free to send me over an email at connect@joannalynn.ca. Or you can even reach me through my website, of course, which is www.joannalynn.ca, or find me on Facebook with my name. Those are all the ways we can stay connected. So thank you so much for being here with me, and have yourself a great rest of the day.
Thanks.
Thank you.